Let's welcome out singer, songwriter, Joy McKean. Big hand to Joy McKean.
Well, I've walked a mile or two in my lifetime.
Joy, it is such a delight to catch up with you today. It has been too long since we last saw each other, but we've seen each other in some amazing adventures across the years at Tamworth Country Music Festivals and
yes.
concerts, and the memories are some of my most treasured from my career. So thank you. Thank you is the first thing I'll say.
Thank you indeed, Angela. There's been a lot of fun in some of those places that we've met, so I always keep an eye out for you.
Oh, do you? Well, that's very nice of you. Thank you.
Slim really was a keen songwriter, and he liked my songwriting.
Congratulations on this documentary. Was it something you had to think about doing, or were you on board from the beginning? Because documentaries can be quite intrusive. You give a lot of yourself.
Yes. My grandson, James, had spent years getting a great archive of everything ready because he wanted to do documentary. And when I wrote the last book, Being on the Road with Slim, but from a woman's point of view, and I mean, let's face it, Angela, it's a little bit different from the lady's side of it, a woman's side of it, to what it is to the men's side of being out there and out and about.
And there's all this amazing, never-before-seen Super 8 vision. Did you have any idea that was all out there?
We had an old camera, you know, and often we would take bits when we were travelling. James just got in and found all of this stuff from, like, everywhere. Some of it I think I should have gone back and edited to Angela, but I just left it there.
Let's go back to the beginning for you. The first thing that I think is important to talk about is that you had polio when you were four. What impact, in retrospect, did that have on your life?
That really made life very different for me because from the age of five, I suppose I was mainly away from my family for nearly 3 years. School holidays, I got a chance to see my parents, mainly because they were country school teachers. I was 8 when the Kenny clinic where I was being treated said they couldn't do any more for me. Mum and Dad applied to come back to Sydney, so I was back with the family again then. We went to a little place called Yandera in the Southern Highlands. Mum and Dad had to make the decision of whether they cosseted me so that I wouldn't jolly well break that leg, which might not mend properly, or whether I was watched the best they could but let me go. And they decided they'd let me go. I was encouraged to do everything that I could. They didn't want me to grow up thinking I had to sit in a corner being an invalid or anything like that. They knew I could do things, and they encouraged me to do that. They were wonderful.
Do you think being around adults, often being alone, was maybe one of the sparks of your ability to tell such a great story?
Yes, I was encouraged to read. I found that I could study well and learn quickly. And then as I grew to be, you know, like only 9 and 10, the music came along.
When the postman delivered a letter.
I used to sing around the place and the family knew I could sing a bit. Mum showed me how to strum on the piano when I was about 7 or 8, you know, and how to put the chords together. Dad and Mum played the Hawaiian steel guitar.
Oh, wow.
I found I could strum on that and sing. So Mum and Dad then started buying me the old vinyl Regal Xenophone records, learnt songs, began yodelling.
Of course.
And of course, anything I did, Heather reckoned she could do. It's like Annie Oakley, you can do, I can do better. So she was into it as well.
Singing as we go, my sister and I.
Once a fortnight, from Yandera on the train, a Saturday morning, either Mum or Dad would get Heather and me on the train down to Sydney and have a lesson on guitar and ukulele at the old Hawaiian club. We ended up having our first radio appearance when I was 10 or 11. Heather was, as I say, 2 years younger.
On 2GB, I believe, was it?
Yeah.
And the incredible thing is you and Heather then went on to be the first women to have their own radio show.
And we must have been about the youngest too. We had half an hour every Saturday night, 6:30. We played the latest records. People that were in town came in and sang live. Jimmy Little, for instance, he made his first radio appearance actually on our Melody Trail show.
Did he?
Yes, he was a young fella, about 17. His uncle brought him up from the coast.
Teleport to glory, oh what a joy divine. I can feel the current moving on the line.
That was in the late 40s and early 50s, you know. The radio at night reached a lot further than what it does now. So we got fan mail from everywhere and it was real fun, but we had not a clue on what we were supposed to do. We were just given this half hour by Alert Radio.
You've been fooling around on me right from the start.
Tell me, how did this bloke Slim come into your life? And did you like him at first or did he have to win you over a bit?
Well, Slim didn't know anything about our background. He knew darn well we had the show. He used to listen to it. Mm-hmm. I think he thought I was just a stuck-up city piece, you know, that sort of thing, so he'd keep his head down. And I thought, well, he had tickets on himself. He was a bit up himself. And I wasn't at all. Neither one of us was terribly impressed with the other one at the time, but that was first. And then, of course, went to the showboat. Him and Shorty, they were chasing two Queensland girls all night. So that was that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had a few marks against him, but that was a big one.
That's a mighty big one, yeah. I'd say, yes.
Right. So it took him a while to get back after that.
I'll bet. Was there something that finally won you over?
Yes. As you know, with the polio, I have to wear a caliper on my left leg. And the caliper fits through a socket on the heel of my shoe. Sure enough, here we were out somewhere around about Forbes or something like that. And I didn't have spare shoes with me. In those days, I mostly only had the one pair because they had to be specially made. And of course, I couldn't walk. It broke through the heel. And I was in a nice old state. And it was Slim that said to Timmy, park the car, you know. And Slim said to me, give me your shoe. So actually, he took my shoe off. He walked around till he found a shoemaker. He got it fixed. And then he came back and he just knelt down on the curb there and very carefully, very gently, put the shoe on. Yet he never made any reference to it. So far as he was concerned, he didn't upset my sense of independence. And that was when I decided that there was a great facade to Slim that I really needed to find out more about.
It's a long straight road and the engine is deep.
Lights on the Hill, of course, we have to talk about. When you wrote that song, did you know immediately this was something special?
Well, there weren't many of that type of songs around. Someone said to me once, oh, you must have known there was a trucking music scene when you wrote it. I said, well, don't. I had no idea. I mean, we would be out on the road and cars didn't have radios like everybody has a radio now. Those days, you sort of didn't have in your car.
Find a little bread for his mouth and a home for a girl as sweet as my honey can be.
Colleen Trenwith, the fiddle player from the Hamilton Bluegrass Band, was there. And she started into it with the Cajun fiddles as soon as I sang it to her. I said, don't you think it would be good for Slim? She said, really right for him. And Slim said, no. Too many words.
Too many words.
No, you can't get to breath or anything like that. Give it to somebody else.
You, of course, won the first Golden Guitar Award at the Tamworth Country Music Festival.
Yeah, I was thrilled. That was with Lights, of course. Up to around about that time, the artist singing was the focus of everything. Things began to change and songwriters became more important.
Well, it's the long straight road, the engine is deep.
There was a time a little 10-year-old boy called Keith Urban came up with the sheet music for Lights on the Hill and asked you to sign it. He's done quite well. He's gone on to some success, but he is in this doco. What's the special relationship with Keith and you and Slim?
We like Keith. He was sort of upsetting the establishment at many times musically. I think Slim and I were supposed to be looking with some disapproval, and on the other hand, we're laughing our heads off. He is one person who I say was very much like Slim. totally driven by his music, totally determined. There was one channel. He still is a very, very nice fella and he's a good friend.
Slim and Joy were definitely trailblazers and they set a precedent.
They were fearless, absolutely fearless.
And we've got some other beautiful people in the docker. Yeah. You've got Paul Kelly, you've got Casey Chambers, Troy Cassidaly.
So many friends.
Beautiful friends that you've made over the years.
Oh, I couldn't believe that there are so many people were so happy to take part in it. And they've said some very wonderful things.
Did you have to pay them much? I'm joking.
Serves me right if I had to, Angela.
I'm joking.
That was a mean one. That got under my guard.
That would never have had to happen.
It's a long, tough pull from away down south. A man's got to find a little bread for his mouth.
They all worship you. I know they do because I've spoken to them about you over the years.
Oh, look. Well, I was thrilled last year to hear all of them came down. Put their take on my songs. Oh, Angela.
That was for your 90th birthday, wasn't it?
On my 90th birthday.
What a party.
What a party. It was a good party, all right. That was a pinnacle of friendship for me.
Yeah.
I could never just thank all of them individually. I never was able to track them all down at once to do it even. Mm-hmm. That's one of the best nights of my life, I think.
I can't talk to you about Slim without talking about what it was like when you lost him. You'd been so close for so long, on the road, your beautiful family. You were two halves of one whole almost.
Mm.
How did you get through it?
I couldn't even write. I couldn't do anything for a long time. First, I threw myself into work because Slim knew I had this other book just about finished. He knew that the whole publicity thing was done, so I just worked as hard as I could.
Yeah.
And it's taken years.
As you know, I lost my husband 3 years ago.
Yeah.
You're right, you do. You start with work, don't you?
Yeah.
And hug your beautiful family.
Yeah, I'm lucky. I've got a wonderful, wonderful family.
You do?
A whole lot of them. Grandkids.
Yep.
Grandchildren.
A whole box of nights, you've got a lot of them.
Oh, you find yourself saying, oh, must tell Slim that. You know, we talk about him, we laugh about him, you know, things he used to do. Everyone in the family, I suppose, has got some little story they want to tell about Slim. Pa or Dad, you know.
Yep.
It gradually has become easier over time, but there are some times when you talk about everything, of course, it brings it back very vividly because he was such a strong presence in our family. See him on stage, you'd have no idea.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, the grandchildren loved him.
Where does the wind go after the storm?
Well, it's exciting that this doco is about to hit the big screen and there's even a soundtrack.
And it's got a new song on there.
Has it?
Yes, it's a song I wrote 2 years after Slim died and then I put the cassette away for 15 years. I wrote the original song.
Yep.
The song's called I Don't Believe You. James sings the lead.
Yep.
Flora is singing and playing button accordion. And then comes into the last verse. So there you are. You've got three generations involved with this, Angela.
That is wonderful.
See, so you can't tell me I'm not a lucky lady.
Oh, you are a lucky lady. And we're all lucky to be able to see your life celebrated on the screen like this. Thank you so much for chatting to me today.
Thank you, Angela.
Take these words, my